Now, I am delighted to introduce our final panel for today, which is addressing educational underachievement on the island. No doubt an issue that will be of interest to many of those who are tuning in this afternoon. Joining us for the discussion are Dr. Noel Purdy, who is Director of the Centre for Research in Educational Underachievement in Stranmills University College, where he's also Director of the Centre for Research in Educational Underachievement. He's been the Northern Co-Chair of the All-Ireland Standing Conference on Teacher Education North and South, SCOTINS, that the Minister referenced earlier, since 2006. And in 2020, he was appointed Independent Chair of the Expert Panel on Educational Underachievement, and they published their report and their action plan in June 2021.
Hello, my name is Dr. Noel Purdy, and I'm Director of Research and Scholarship here at Stranmills University College in Belfast. I'm also Director of the Centre for Research in Educational Underachievement. And until very recently, I was the Northern Co-Chair of SCOTINS, which is the Standing Conference on Teacher Education North and South. In relation to educational underachievement, I was appointed Chair of the Expert Panel on Educational Underachievement here in Northern Ireland in July of last year. And that panel was established as part of the New Decade, New Approach political settlement of January 2020. So on the 1st of June of this year, we launched A Fair Start, which was the final report and the action plan from the work of the expert panel. A Fair Start includes 47 costed actions across 8 key areas. And those key areas are, I'm sure, familiar to all of you. But our main priority was the very first one, which was a focus on the early years and greater investment in the early years. We moved on through a number of other key areas, focusing on emotional health and well-being, curriculum and assessment, developing a whole community approach to education, maximizing boys' potential, professional development opportunities for teachers and school leaders, and finally, moves to ensure interdepartmental collaboration. As a preface to today's discussion, I believe very strongly in the principles of educational equality and educational opportunity. I believe in the principles of social mobility, that where you start in life shouldn't determine your future, that your potential, your merit, and your choices should determine your outcomes, not where you grew up or the place that you happened to go to school. I've always felt that I was one of the lucky ones. I grew up in a council estate. My father left school at 14. My mother is a retired nurse. And yet I have received a very good education. And now I'm very fortunate to work in a beautiful college like Stranmillis. I'm one of the lucky ones. But all the statistics that we looked at here in Northern Ireland confirm that far too few children from the background that I come from achieve similar success. That's unfair. It's not good enough. It's not good enough for Northern Ireland. It's not good enough for all of our children. And that's what my own work here at Stranmillis and also the work of the expert panel seeks to change, so that every child, irrespective of their background, does indeed have a fair start.
Thank you very much, Noel. Mary Jackson is our next panellist, and she's principal of Ardee Community School in County Louth, a role she's held since 2006. Ardee Community School is a DESH school with a rapidly growing student population. She is member of the National Executive Association of Community and Comprehensive Schools and is chairperson of its DESH subcommittee. She's also chairperson of Deeside School Completion Programme, which supports young people and their families in Mid Louth and the Knobber area of County Meath.
My name is Mary Jackson. I am principal of a large DESH post-primary school of over 1,100 students in Ardee County Louth. DESH, which stands for Delivering Equality of Opportunity in Schools, is an action plan for education inclusion published by the Department of Education. Its latest plan was published in 2017. There are 5 key goals and actions in this framework. The first is to implement a robust and responsive assessment framework for the identification of schools and effective resource allocation, to improve the learning outcomes and outcomes of students in DESH schools, to improve the capacity of school leaders and teachers to engage, plan, and deploy resources to the best advantage. To support and foster best practice in schools through interagency collaboration, and to support the work of schools by providing research, information, evaluation, and feedback to achieve the goals of the plan. Schools like ours are supported in the following way to achieve their goals at a local level. We are provided with additional DESH grants, enhanced teacher and guidance allocation, funding for book grant schemes, access to homeschool community liaison officers, school completion and enhanced education programs, such as the Junior Cert Schools program and the Leaving Cert Applied program, support for professional developments and the support of outside agencies, such as NEPS, TUSLA, etc. As a school, we are expected to have a 3-year DESH action plan. This plan is our school plan and underpins everything we do in our school. We plan under the 7 pillars of DESH as follows: numeracy, literacy, attainment, transitions, retention, attendance, and links with parents and the community. All teachers in our school are involved in DESH planning. They plan around actions which support the most vulnerable and at risk in our community. This plan underpins everything we do in our school, and the resources mentioned are specifically targeted at those for whom the data shows need it most. We do this without making it obvious of whom we're helping in our community. The leading of a DESH school is from the Board of Management down to individual classroom, and it's crucial to the successful outcomes of the plan. What does this mean at a local level? It means we support parents in involving them in their child's education, some of who have not had a great educational experience themselves. Our homeschool community liaison officer is an important link with home and in encouraging and welcoming and supporting parents. The removal of barriers by having a book scheme for everybody, by having links with outside agencies such as St. Vincent de Paul, NEPS, TUSLA, and the school completion are important. Knowing our incoming students before they come to us by establishing a robust transfer program and links with our local primary schools. Supporting the transition from junior to senior cycle with equality of access to all programs and subjects. Aspiring to have high expectations of all our students and supporting them to achieve their potential. Finally, we robustly evaluate our targets and outcomes to measure their success for our students.
Thank you, Mary. Emma Shaw is our third panelist, and she is a community activist with a particular focus on education. She advocates for community-driven approaches to education policy and believes in bottom-up initiatives. She's conducted in-depth research with groups including young people, women, residence groups, and former loyalist prisoners, and is a proponent of policy solutions that are community-driven, community-focused, and community-led. She's currently pursuing her MA in educational policy and planning.
So my interest in education stems from leaving school at 16 with qualifications and then entering the workforce. I didn't then go back to education until I was 35. And a large part of that was I came from a low income area in East Belfast, and I never really felt that education and university was something that was achievable for me. It was only as I got a little bit more confident as I got older that I decided to take the chance and go back to university to study international politics. And it was through my degree that I really became an advocate for educational change within Northern Ireland. And any attempts at tackling educational underachievement must be community driven, community focused, and community led. Top-down approaches have had minimal impact, and it is time for bottom-up initiatives. And this means looking at how funding is structured and removing barriers for communities to access longer-term funding for educational progress. There also has to be political willpower to enact these changes. In Northern Ireland, we've had several reports on educational underachievement, but there's no follow-up, and we can't keep going in circles with reports and policy recommendations if we want to see real and meaningful change. A student's socioeconomic status should not be an indicator of their academic outcomes, but unfortunately it is. And pupils who are entitled to free school meals are outperformed academically by their more affluent counterparts. This is not just a Northern Ireland or a UK or an Ireland issue, but a global one. And we can learn from best practices that have been successful in other countries. We need to readdress how we measure student success and have a more holistic approach rather than simply test scores. A factor in Northern Ireland is the continued use of the transfer test at age 11. And there is a multitude of academic research that shows that these high stakes tests are not an accurate reflection of a student's ability. Yes, teachers should be allowed to test pupils in class to ensure they understand the material, but high stakes tests like the transfer test, which dictates what type of school you will go to, must be confined to the past.
Thank you very much, Emma. Now, there's so much to discuss, but I think to begin our discussion, it might be good to have a shared understanding of what we actually mean by educational underachievement. So, Noel, since that report has only come out recently from you and your group, could you share with us what you had defined as educational underachievement, or what you understand it to mean?
Thanks, Eivin, and it's great to be part of this discussion today. Well, as a panel, we decided to adopt quite a broad interpretation of educational underachievement, and there are many different definitions which were possible to consider. We decided, to look at it really as an issue of educational inequality and the inequality of opportunity and attainment between particular groups within our communities and society. And that's really how we considered it. Part of our terms of reference asked us to focus specifically on Protestant working class boys. And there's been a lot of focus on that in terms of policy and discussion in Northern Ireland over recent years. But actually what we discovered very quickly was that the main differences in terms of achievement or opportunity weren't between Protestants and Catholics and those communities. It wasn't even between girls and boys. The biggest difference in terms of achievement was between pupils who were in receipt of free school meals and those who weren't in receipt of free school meals. To give you a quick example, I know time is short. In terms of Catholic against Protestant pupils, the differences were around 3 percentage points in terms of GCSE achievement. Those are the exams at the age of 16. Between girls and boys, the differences are around 8%. Between free school meal entitled and non-free school meal entitled, the differences are around 28 or 29 percentage points. And interestingly, to go back to Emma's point, the difference between grammar schools and non-grammar schools is 37 percentage points. So the differences are not necessarily between the two communities, even though there's a lot of focus on that in Northern Ireland. The biggest differences were as a result of socioeconomic background.
Mm-hmm. And that's something, you know, that I came across very strongly in each of your videos there, that, you know, it's not right that someone's educational background, someone's socioeconomic background defines on how well that they will do educationally. Mary, this is obviously something that's very relevant, very important to you and your school. And I wanted to ask you, you know, how do you nurture that culture of leadership in your school that is welcoming to everybody, and where there's no discernible difference between a student who might actually need more support and a student who may not, but within the same classroom, within the same school?
Okay, we do this in a very a very seamless way by supporting those students quietly without making it obvious that they are getting support to others within the school community. And I think that's very, very important, because they see their differences as big differences, and their families see the differences as being quite substantial as well. But within the classroom, it is very important that they are treated equally, that they're given equality of access right across the curriculum to every subject that they're encouraged to achieve as highly as they can within their own abilities within those classrooms. And that we put in those supports. For example, we're starting after school study again next year after a break, or next week, I should say. And what we will do is our homeschool community liaison officer will support and encourage families to participate in this. And there is a charge for after school study, but this charge comes through our school app, and so nobody knows who's paid and who hasn't paid. And I think the same with school meals. You know, we have a breakfast club with over 200 students participating this week alone, and it's very important that that anybody is free to go into that breakfast club, but that students who need it most are really encouraged to come to school early to have that little bit of dialogue that happens over the breakfast, and that they come, that they are welcome in the school, and that they have a meaningful adult to talk to them when they do come in.
And I know, I taught myself in a deaf school, I know that those kind words, that those interactions can actually make such a difference to how a student then is prepared to actually go into the school day. But I just want to ask you on that, and I'll come to Emma then. I just want to ask you about funding for that, Mary. Is that something that you constantly have to fight for? If it's something that you really want to provide the service, you really want to make sure that no student is excluded, whether they can pay for it or not. So is that something that you then have to really be careful about, how you fund these extra services that are there for the benefit of the learners in your school?
Yes, we have to be absolutely sure that our targeted students have the benefit of the funding that's provided. And the government initiative around DESH provides us with quite a substantial amount of funding in a number of different areas. And we spoke about school meals there. You know, that is funded from a different department within government, and really, really important. That I suppose that the focus is on the students who need it absolutely most. The same with our DESH funding, the same with the homeschool community liaison officer. She will support all parents, but she will have her targeted families who she will link in with regularly and establish a good relationship with those families in supporting their education. Because as I said earlier, you know, very often those families have had a poor experience of education, would have possibly been early school leavers, and also would maybe not have had the experience of going on to further and higher education.
And I wonder if that adds to your day, Mary, if the funding is coming from two different departments, and that actually you have to follow that up. But we may come back to that. Emma, I wanted to ask you specifically, because, you know, you really focused on the community element of this, that, you know, the top down, it doesn't always get to the people that it's actually trying to target. So how can we better fund the community work that you've identified is really necessary to target educational disadvantage?
Thanks for your question, Amy. So the way the funding is set up can sometimes be challenging for community-based organizations to access. They maybe don't have the skill set to complete the very in-depth funding requirements, setting up objectives, and that can be one barrier. But another barrier is it's short-term funding. So say, for example, for 2 or 3 years. And when you're trying to look at educational underachievement or address the root issues, it's not something that can happen in 2 to 3 years. It's something that needs a longer term strategic plan, possibly 7 to 10 year funding. And so that is something that I would advocate for community-based organizations to be able to access.
What do you mean when you say community-based organizations? You know, who exactly are those people that you would like to see getting that support so that they can work with those families, work with those children?
So the types of organizations that I'm referring to are community-based organizations that are community-led, and very often they're community members that are leading these organizations. They know their community well, they know the issues and the troubles that the young people or even the older people face, but they just don't necessarily don't have the networks to tap into to be able to access the funding or to be able to take it to the next level. And so there is a gap in perhaps training there, where these individuals can also receive upskill or retraining to ensure that they have the capabilities to apply for funding and to follow projects through. As you said, I'm an advocate for community-based, community-led, community-driven organizations and initiatives, because it's the community members on the ground that best know the barriers that they face to education and the particular issues that are surrounding an area.
So it's maybe not just the schools that we should be looking at in having certain programs and strategies, but actually there needs to be wraparound structures to help the wider community that is getting targeted, I guess.
Yes, so there needs to be partnership between schools and the organisations. And I know in Northern Ireland, there already is partnership within some charity groups and other organisations. But at the same time, I sort of feel that politicians in Northern Ireland want to put everything in schools. There's a problem, there's an issue that needs fixed. I know we'll get schools to get a programme to address it. And schools aren't provided with much additional resources or training for the teachers. Sometimes in these situations, it would be better for a community-based organization to take the lead and have a partnership with the school, because as Mary is probably aware, there are barriers for some individuals and young people to even get into school. And so if we're just offering the services within a school setting, then we're already putting a barrier to those young people or families' engagement. And so by having the organizations based within the community, who may be more culturally responsive to what the individual's needs are, then we have a better chance of succeeding and getting those individuals engaged.
So it's highlighting those different pathways and those different people that actually need to be there along the line of supports for somebody who would really benefit from having those extra funding, the extra supports. I'm going to take a question from our audience. This is Maria Campbell at St. Angela's College in Sligo, and she's the co-chair of Scotians in the South. And so Maria, we'll come to you for your question, please.
Good evening, thanks very much. And thanks for the opportunity to talk to everyone here today. And I was delighted and really enthralled by the discussion from the panel. My question to the panel is as such: I'm wondering, an organisation like Scotians, is there something more we could do? Could we perhaps shift our focus to somewhat? Are there other initiatives that we could engage in? And to help you answer that, I just might briefly give you an overview of the three key areas that Scotians currently looks at or engages in. The first is we run an annual conference in October, and normally pre-COVID it was over 2 days, and we used to invite in, say, educational experts. This year we have Professor Stephen Ball, we had Etienne Wenger-Trainer, Marilyn Copton-Smith, so to bring international and national experts in and give them the opportunity to speak with all our colleagues. We'd have a doctoral workshops run by principals, workshops run by teachers, researchers sharing their expertise, principal groups together. So really a coming together of everybody with an interest in teacher education. The second initiative would be our student teacher exchange, where student teachers spend 3 weeks doing an assessed placement in the other jurisdiction. And then we bring them all together at the very end of the year and evaluate it and get them all to mix and discuss their experiences. And our final focus would be on research. And I was very interested to hear some of the participants say that they were delighted to see that, you know, there's a focus this time on educational underachievement in particular. So we have seed funding on an annual basis where we invite partners north and south to come together and pick an area of interest. And we're absolutely delighted to have the support of the Shared Island Initiative this year for that targeted piece of research. So that's a very brief overview, but we're growing and we're learning. And I'd love to know, are there areas that you think we could focus on, we should focus on, because we have a unique I suppose, membership of individuals and organisations across the whole breadth of the island and coming from various backgrounds?
Lovely. That's a great question. Yeah, so we have this organisation there, Scotans, which focuses on teacher education. And we know that teachers are key to learners, and particularly learners who might be at risk of educational underachievement. You know, their teacher is a key person in their life. So could we be asking more of Scotians? And Noel, in your role, can I ask this question of you? And perhaps, is there additional goals that you could see coming from Scotians?
Well, I think it's important to say at the outset that Scotians has been doing this kind of work for almost 20 years. And, you know, there are natural synergies between Scotians as that safe space for teacher educators and the work of the Shared Island initiative and the Shared Island unit. So it's a natural synergy which we see in this research call that's out at the moment. And I think it's very exciting. The kind of work that we were doing in the first start, and Minister Foley mentioned it in her address a few moments before, when she talked about the fact that we had engaged with DESH officials. And it's wonderful to see Mary on this panel as well today, because I think too often in Northern Ireland, we like to think that we've got particular problems. And of course, we do have particular problems in Northern Ireland, and I'm not denying that. But we can always learn from the experience of others in other jurisdictions, whether that's in the Republic of Ireland or indeed in other parts of the UK or further afield. And I think that's one element that's part of this research call as well, where it's not just north-south, but actually is open to east-west or international advisors and so on. I think that's very welcome. And that sort of move away from the parochialism, I think, of Northern Ireland, which is can too often be inward looking. And yes, we've got particular problems, but actually we can learn so much. We had such a fruitful discussion with the DESH officials. I would love to learn more about Mary's school and about how DESH works in practice, because there are so many elements that we were excited to learn about as a panel, not least the homeschool community liaison officers that Mary has talked about today. And so there are so many opportunities, I think, for school towns, but for educators and teacher educators to learn. We have been doing it in school towns for almost 20 years. It's been an incredibly fruitful space and an opportunity for dialogue and understanding and learning. And I'm just keen to see that develop in any way that's possible.
And just on that, Mary, can you actually share some information on the DESH school and what qualifies a school to receive DESH status? Because that's one question that's come in, because it's obviously very different to how things would be done in Northern Ireland.
Okay. Basically, every DESH school is unique in the country and would have a unique set of factors which would qualify them for DESH status. And for example, the big urban schools, you know, would have their own set of issues and background which would qualify them. And the main area that qualifies schools for DESH status is the local popular census figures and the information that and research that's generated from that area. And for example, like our school would be classified as having roughly one third of the students in the DESH category of our 1,100 students, which is a substantial number. And if you look at the context of our town, maybe to illustrate it a little bit, you know, we're the biggest employer in the town. There are a number of small industries in the town, but there's no major industry. And I think the last recession in 2008, 2012, 2013 really brought home how precarious the situation in our rural area. You know, we're 55 minutes from the airport, and our population would be very heavily involved in the service industry, particularly the construction service industry. And the impact of the last recession was really huge on our school community, because so many people who were working successfully and were very skill based and suddenly lost their positions, you know, and went from having, you know, a decent wage or salary coming in to really being without employment. And that had a huge impact beyond the level of DESH in an area like Ardee. But as I say, some of the urban DESH schools would have a very, very different context and would have high unemployment rates and would have a huge dependency on social welfare and would have a high level of, say, lack of progression onto a third level, you know, and all of those factors add to give schools their DESH allocation, basically.
Okay, thank you for that, Mary. Thank you. We're going to take a question now from Emily Stanton from Community Relations in Schools. Emily, can we take your question, please? Hi.
Yes, hi. My question is directed at the panel. Statistics show that that attainment inequalities can also be linked to Northern Ireland communities impacted by the legacy of conflict. And I'm wondering if panel members would suggest that targeted funds should be invested more heavily in those communities that have been highly impacted by the legacy of conflict.
Emma, I will go to you on this because I imagine that this feeds into the, you know, the research that you yourself have done and the work that you have done with communities. Should the communities who've been specifically impacted by conflict, do they need, you know, targeted supports and focused supports to ensure that the young people in those communities are getting to progress and to really, you know, fulfill their potential?
100% we need targeted funds. And that is part of what I was speaking about earlier, is the communities will know what or have an idea of what their members need, whether it's retraining, upskilling, help with career employment, or getting those maths and English skills that are necessary for most of the jobs within the economy now, especially within areas that are still reeling from the troubles. We've seen shops shut on high streets way before COVID even hit. Targeted funds, but also need to address some type of partnership with community-led organizations. Because again, this top-down approach, if we're going to have targeted funds, we must have community input. It's no good having targeted funds and allocating them to a particular area and then not seeking any input from the community on what their actual needs are. Because quite often, and this is what has spurred me on to do my undergraduate research, was outsiders speaking for my community and speaking on what they thought that we needed without any engagement with the community.
I think it's so key to, you know, so many areas of research now where the engagement is actually, it's so important. You have to speak to the people that you're trying to benefit, or that you're saying that you're trying to benefit, that they're actually within all of the work that you do from start to finish. And so I think that's key to consider, Emma, when we're talking about funds, when we're talking about educational programs. I've got a question now from Jennifer McKenzie, who's director of the National Centre for Guidance in Education. Jennifer, your contribution, please. Hi.
Hi, Aveen. Thank you very much for inviting me to speak to you today at this. Just to say it's an excellent dialogue and it's great to be part of it. There's just one comment, though, that I would make, which relates to this panel and the previous panels as well. And that's the issue of guidance provision. And when we're talking about access to information so that a student can make a choice, and as Noel was saying there about having the opportunity to move from one community into an opportunity for work, it's crucial to have guidance available to students in schools and to the general community outside of schools. And we don't currently have a formal system where we interact on a cross-border basis. So the NCGE, our organisation, would liaise on an informal basis with our colleagues in Northern Ireland, with the Careers NI service, and we've done that for a number of years. But our systems are very, very different. So it'll be a wonderful opportunity as a result of this event to potentially look at that opportunity to set up that sort of collaborative activity, because I can almost guarantee the guidance counsellors in the South, in both schools and the adult guidance and the further education and training and the higher education services, aren't aware necessarily of all of the opportunities that are available in the North and vice versa. So I think we've an opportunity. And also just to say as well that one of the key messages of guidance provision is to support decision making. So it's not just about what's available, it's how is it relevant to me. And in the South, we've introduced the area of guidance related learning to 12, 13 and 14 year olds in first year, second and third year. So you're beginning that discussion, you're beginning that exploration. So students in DESH schools, in non-DESH schools, can actually start to look at, well, what is relevant to me and what am I interested in? Because it's crucial that we remember it's the students that we're all supporting in all of our endeavours. So thanks very much.
Thank you, Jennifer. And perhaps there is a space in Scotians in the future to include the guidance counsellors. I'm not going to jump on your role there, Noel. But Jennifer's comment is pertinent because, as you said in your report, you were specifically asked to look at the Protestant boys in working class areas as a group that definitely needed support. But as you were saying, you know, it spans all communities, and it's actually down to, you know, it's the family income, the family status, that's actually the condition that's really affecting the students in that. So, you know, if we have those options available to kids, if they don't want to necessarily stay in to do all their A levels or all the way to their leaving cert, that they know that there are other options out there, that guidance would be really important. What do you think about that, Noel?
Yeah, I couldn't agree more with that. And I think it would be a tremendous opportunity to have more North-South communication in that regard. We certainly heard consistent messages from disadvantaged communities about careers, education and guidance. We heard it as well from school leaders about the lack of value given to more vocational forms of education. And a lot of our young people are not aware of the range of opportunities that are available to them. And there's a prioritization of more academic routes. And I think that is really selling our young people short, because there are many, many fantastic opportunities available, not just in schools, but in further education in Northern Ireland. And at the moment, the message we heard was that too many young people from disadvantaged communities are not even aware of what those opportunities are. To go back to something that Emma said as well, another of our recommendations was very much in line with what she's suggesting there about a place-based approach, a new scheme called Reducing Educational Disadvantage, which would be co-designed and based on authentic partnership between schools and communities. And that's exactly what's needed. And even to go back to Emily's question before that, because some communities will need more attention in certain areas than others, and the communities are the people who know best what is needed there. In terms of opportunity, there's a fantastic opportunity with the Fair Start report. But as Emma said, there have been a number of reports in the past from which no tangible result has emerged. This report that we worked on is potentially very different. It was minister-led. It has now been endorsed in principle by all five executive parties. The new Minister of Education in Northern Ireland has endorsed it as well. And there is, I think, a willingness to move forward on this, but it's got to be translated into funding. And it's not just coming from the Department of Education. It requires substantial funding, £180 million over 5 years. And that requires the Northern Ireland Executive to step up and to deliver real change in our communities. The panel has done, I think, a fantastic work in bringing this report together, consulting very widely with hundreds of people across Northern Ireland. The evidence is clear. We've known the evidence for a long time. The actions are now written, and that's another key difference about this report, because we have costed actions, 47 of them in place. Now we just need the executive to prioritise our young people's future. It's part of the programme for government in Northern Ireland to give our young people the best start in life. That's one of the the 12 outcomes of the current programme for government. Now we need politicians to step up and to deliver this and to prioritise it with funding so that actual change happens in our communities.
Thank you very much, Noel. And I think for me, the learnings from this conversation, this panel discussion, are the need for political will, the problem of short-term funding, removing barriers to distinguishing the students in their school, and I guess to recognise that this is a complex issue and it's not just one that can be solved in schools by the school community, but it actually needs to be addressed by a broader issue and possibly over a number of governmental departments as well. That's both North and South. So thank you so much for your time and for your insight today. Emma Shaw, Dr. Noel Purdy and Mary Jackson, thank you sincerely. And that closes our conversation for today and our shared dialogue on Education North and South. Thank you so much for joining us. I hope you found the conversations insightful and interesting, that you've given you food for thought on the issues that you might be able to address in your own sphere and in your own communities. Thank you so much for your contributions throughout as well, because it really made the panel discussions all the more interactive and all the more interesting. You can continue the conversation online with the hashtag #SharedIsland if you like, and there will be a report and videos that'll go online in the coming days on the Shared Island website. Thank you for all of our panelists today, and thank you to all of our contributors, as I said, for their time and their input, and I hope you enjoy the rest of your Friday. Slán tamall.